We have been educating our own young engineers to appreciating them to write papers. So I see the crowd and I see many of you are young engineers. So young aspiring engineers, if not the whole engineers as such. So let us see. Okay. So any doubts, you wait till the end of the presentation, because I don't want to be interrupted because I have a lot of things to cover. We will go through slowly and let's see how it goes. At the outset, let me tell you that I myself, I am not a professor don't have any doctorate degree or something. I'm just an engineer, but I have been following the advice of many professors. One such professor whom I really follow regarding, especially regarding research, is Professor Debabrata Das of IIIT Bangalore. So many of the slides which I have taken, I asked him, and I am reproducing it to a certain degree for clarification, because he is my mentor. And I follow him wholeheartedly. So he is there in the field for many years, and I like to follow somebody. So this is advice for youngsters: try to follow one professor or your guide or somebody, because it helps you and smoothen things out. Okay, let's begin. So I have just four contents which I want to cover today. The first topic itself is not IEEE paper; it is plagiarism. It has become a big thing, big issue, especially for Indians. I will explain shortly why it is so. And then we will come into the IEEE paper format. And then we'll see what is the order of writing the paper itself and some pointers towards the end. So let's start with plagiarism. How many of you know what plagiarism is? I wonder. It is control C, control V for the young generations. Copy pasting without giving credit to the actual source of the material. Okay. So as per IEEE concerned, it is not illegal to copy as long as you code them. Okay, it's not illegal. You can copy a line from a textbook. You can copy a line from another paper. It's all okay as long as you do not forget to mention the authors. Now here comes the tricky part. I will show you one small screenshot or screen, a sheet of paper, and I want you to observe the names in that list. Okay. So I'm going to change the presentation and I'm going to show you another small list of material which I wanted to see. So just hold on a second. Okay. This is a list of IEEE prohibited authors list. Just observe the name and you'll observe a pattern in the name. It's a huge list. I am scrolling through it very fast. I don't want you to read the names. But one thing which you will see about these names is majority of them are Indians. And in IEEE, you get banned for plagiarism for 5 years. It's as good as losing your academic career. Suicide it is actually, okay? So I just wanted to see that many of it are Indians. Majority, in fact, I would say, are Indians. Since I have made that point very clear to you, let's go further. So never, never copy paste in another paper, put the title of your name, change the title, change the things, and don't expect to get away with it. It is not good for your career, academic career at least. Okay. That list is not shared with everybody. You will not know whether you have been blacklisted or not. Sometimes you submit a paper and you reject it multiple times. This may be one of the reasons which may happen. So I am warning all the young students, do not do plagiarism. Do not ruin the name of the country. Okay. How do you know his paper is plagiarized? It is by something called a similarity index. People who have submitted papers will know what this means actually. So just hold on a second. I will show you what a similarity list looks like. Okay. I'm just stopping the presentation. I'll show it again. Once again, please hold on. So this is a paper which I have written with my colleague. And what you will see is, forget the title and the content, see the highlighted passages. You will see some sections are highlighted here. Okay, and numbers are associated with those papers. Are you able to follow? Some texts are colored. So these colored text represent things which I have taken from some other authors, which are machine generated, and they create a score called similarity index. You see the score? I hope people are seeing this score. So what the percentage is telling? 21%. And it tells from where all I have taken the content from. And these are the sources. Number one, number two, and how much percentage of it I copied in my text. You see this? So this is a text which is generated by the conference organizers, and this shows the similarity index. This means 21% of my paper is sourced from somewhere else. It is sourced from somewhere else. So now let's go back to the slides. For a paper to be accepted, you must need a similarity index less than 20%. This you note down in your head very clearly. 1/5 of the paper only can be reproduced. That is with acknowledgement, including references. Okay. So when you write a paper, always remember, even if you copy too much of the material from another paper, similarity index is going to go high and your paper will get rejected. Okay. Now I will explain a few points on how to avoid this plagiarism itself. Firstly, when you read a paper and you get impressed by the paper, you wish, oh, if only I could write statements like this. Oh, I read this textbook and I like this line very much. Wireless communication. It has to be defined this way. Do not copy that line as it is. Because many of us are not English as a mother tongue. We don't have English as a mother tongue. We have our own mother tongue. You say the same statement in your mother tongue, translate back to a English language, and I guess that will give you safe way to escape from the similarity index. It's a very important key which I'm telling you. It is better to write in your own half-baked English than copy-pasting a line directly from the textbook or another paper. Okay? I have warned you, plagiarism is the most crucial thing which determines whether a paper is accepted itself or not. And even before they read the paper, this is the first check. Okay? Let's now see the paper format itself. So I have sufficiently warned you, this is not a child's play. It's a serious offense if you plagiarize. Okay. You must always use a correct format. Correct format means what? If you're publishing to a conference, it has a different format. If you're publishing to a journal, it has a different format altogether. I'll just show you a difference between the conference paper and the journal paper, just so that you understand what I'm talking about. Many people have already have that experience, so there's no issues. The one which I showed you about similarity index was a conference paper, and I will show you a journal paper. So this is a journal paper. Are you able to see it? That's a journal, the same paper. Because we were rejected by the conference, we thought, okay, we'll improve it upon it and we publish it in a journal. The journal has a different look and feel altogether. Every journal has its own style of working. So you must always follow the format prescribed by the journal publisher. Okay. So once that much is clear, I think I have done a lot of switching in text here and there. Let's go back to the original slides and let's continue from there. Okay. Always reference a conference website and prefer a LaTeX template over a document template. So generally a .doc looks easier to edit for a youngsters, but LaTeX is the golden standard. Okay. It helps you to make camera ready paper very, very easy, and it's much more easier. A separate session can be planned for LaTeX. I think there are a lot of resources in IEEE who tells you how to write a paper on how to write a LaTeX template paper. So that is a separate topic of discussion. For a paper, there are general contents of this on order: abstract, introduction, preliminaries, proposed schemes which are proposing, simulation or results, conclusion, and references. These are the typical contents of a paper. So just I have showed you how a paper looks like. The order to write is not straightforward. Okay, so the title comes last, because title requires a lot of thought, because that is the title of the movie or whatever you want to say. It's like the catching thing. That has to be kept last. You start with the abstract, go to introduction, and directly go to conclusion. Don't come in the middle. Don't write the masala part, the one which you actually work very hard on. The method, the simulation, the result. That's the last thing to write, not the first thing to write. You start with the abstract, then the introduction, then the conclusion. This is not to be written immediately. Of course, this is what you will do first, but when you write it, don't write this first. So again, abstract, introduction, conclusion, then comes the method, summation, results, and title. This order has to be followed strictly. Okay, so I'm not repeating again. Let's go back and see in each of the sections what are things to write, how to write an abstract. So many conferences, in general conferences, I'm talking about general conferences, an abstract has to be written with just 150 words, around 150 words, around left or right, a little bit here and there, you can give or take, around 15 words a sentence, and let's say 10 sentences on an average, 9 or 10 sentences. The first two sentences is the area which you are focusing on and why that area is important. If you're writing a wireless communication, you say 5G, 6G, whatever. If you're writing about communication society, wireless Wi-Fi, you say Wi-Fi is important, so and so. The first two lines are generic lines, very general topic, so that if a reviewer is not from the domain, he gets to know what domain you're talking about before you just show the full thing, okay? The third sentence is about which subpart are you addressing within that area. Sentence 4 and 5 is about what literature survey have you done, what are the open challenges with respect to the above area. So the fourth and fifth line only you will talk about, oh, I read this paper, this is the method which is there, this is the open challenges available. It's not the first line. Our proposed idea will come at the sixth and the seventh line, not the first line. Do not first openly open the statement and say, I found something new. No, you will never say, I found something new in the first line. You will write towards the end, towards the sixth and seventh line only, you will say, our proposed idea mentioned so and so and so is a novel. So if it is a new idea, a novel idea, you must show it politely. You must mention it politely. You do not have to brag. You should not brag in the paper. It should be always with respect, because the one who is reviewing has a little bit more experience than you, so it should not look like bragging, okay? And sentence 8 and 9, you will talk about the results. You should not miss this part. I did improve this and I got this much improvement. You cannot say, I found a new method and don't say anything about the results. You have to say, oh, this is a watch, this is how much good my thing is. And with existing results, so and so is better. Like that, you must step by step by step take it. Okay, so abstract is just 150 words, 10 sentences, that's it. Nothing beyond that. You will not write anything beyond 10 sentences. I explained also sentence by sentence what to write also, right? So just before we go further, I will just show you an abstract which I have written so that you can compare that with the one which we are seeing right now. So I'll just show again, just hold on a second. So this is a paper. The abstract is around 150 words. The first two are supposed to be what? General statements. In the 5G era, Internet of Things, you will find so and so and so in human life. The wireless sensor network becomes easy, so and so and so. Second line finished. Now, third and fourth sentence, they're supposed to go depth within that same domain. What second and sentence? Within the WSN network, I am working on scheduling algorithm. And there are many scheduling algorithms proposed in the literature. Literature survey I'm talking about here. One such method which has gathered intense attention is DDLSM algorithm I'm talking about, which is a literature survey statement. Right? Now, here I am, this is the fifth or sixth statement where I am going to talk about what I have done or what our my colleague have done. This paper proposes a so and so and so activity. Okay, and one more statement regarding this. Now I would show what? Comparison results, I should say, that is better, right? So what is the seventh and eighth statement? Comparison between time allocation so and so and so is improved better. And last statement is I have got this much percentage improvement over the existing implementation. So I am just showing you as it is. This is how you should write an abstract so that it catches the attention of the reviewer. Okay, so let's see, go back to the slides again. So it takes a little bit time to write abstract. It's not that straightforward. It doesn't come within a day. You don't think you can write abstract within 2 hours and finish it off. It may take a day or two to write the statements step by step by step. Okay, let's go to introduction now. If I'm going too fast, please bear with me because I have a time constraint, so I'm going a little bit fast. Okay, introduction. Each bullet point in the abstract in the previous slide will be one paragraph in the introduction. So one line there becomes a paragraph in the introduction. It is like a zooming effect. Like in camera zooming, you understand? You should take a picture and you zoom and see much more details. Each paragraph will have around 4 to 5 sentences. So 5 sentences into 10 statements, 50 statements is maximum for introduction. Okay, don't write Ramayana, don't write all the survey, everything, no. Each paragraph have to explain 4 to 5 statements further. Clearly mention which are the open problem existing. Before you solve the problem, you must state, okay, I have so many problems, and you list them out. In that list, you say which one you are actually addressing or which one you have solved. Okay, while presenting your new idea, because sometimes it happens, because sometimes it's really a patented idea. So you have to, with a new idea, you have to mention politely that it's a novel world, first of its kind, because author, the reviewer must get impressed by that content. Okay, is there something novel more? Okay, explain your idea briefly here. Okay, the details will come later, because how you solve fully will be shown later. It's like a trailer to the next section. Okay, you should also mention a little bit of results also to keep that interest going. Okay, little bit of interest, not the full statement. The last paragraph should be the structure of the paper itself. This may be confusing to some people who have not read much papers. I will show this part in my paper, which is a reference I'm showing. Just hold on a second. So this is my introduction section, which I'm talking with. Each first line is about 5G and IoT. I must write 5 lines about it. So you will find this kind of 5 lines about it. And step by step by step, you will see. And what I want to focus is the last section of the introduction part. Okay. So the remaining paper is arranged as 4 sections. I'm explaining that this paper has 4 sections apart from the introduction and all. Section 2 discusses the preliminaries of the existing algorithm. Don't worry about this word, some algorithm. Section 3 presents my proposed scheme. So before I start with my proposed scheme, I am telling the algorithm itself and discussing about the algorithm. So section 3 will tell the actual method. Section 4 results the simulation and results. Okay, and conclusion is section 5. Like that I'm telling, explaining, right? So now you get the idea. So this is 150 words around. Okay, that you can see. Okay, let's go back. I hope people are following me. So let's go further. So again, I'll repeat shortly. An abstract, every line will become a paragraph, and we must have around 4 to 5 sentences in a paragraph. And you should mention little bit about the idea and little bit about the results. Not fully, little bit. Okay. Now comes the proposed idea and method. This is dependent upon the problem statement which you have taken. So if possible, make a figure of the proposed idea. Always a picture conveys 1,000 words, they say. So always, 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 technically it's possible to draw a picture. Okay, picture, once you show, it clearly explains the whole system. It gets the idea going across very quickly. Instead of an author reading 1,000 words just by picture, he gets the whole concept. And explain the idea with respect to the figure, not something else. You draw a figure and you explain, okay, in this figure, step one is so and so, step two is so and so. Explain the fold, explain the call flow. We'll take him through the steps. Okay. If no figure is possible, that's a very rare case. In some CS domains, some things it's not possible to draw a figure itself. Step by step explanation is an idea. Step wise, you should explain the idea. You have to, as if he's a new, the reviewer has a new domain, you must take him step by step, step by step. Okay. No hurry buries in the proposal. You have enough time, space, and constraint. There's no space constraint here. There is no one paragraph limitation, no number of statements limitation here. You can arms a right proposed idea. Take your time. Explain in details the actual idea which you have. That's the effort you have put. The maximum effort you have put actually in doing things is in this domain. So you must be explaining it accordingly. If you have an abbreviation, wherever you use it, for the first time, you must show the full abbreviation, expand it. So just by saying CDMA or TDMA is not sufficient. The reviewer may understand TDMA in different context. Okay, so you must explain. So you must explain TDMA means time to multiple access the first time you use it, and henceforth you can write as it is. So this is something which many people miss it out. I don't want you to miss it out. Even IoT, the word IoT is very common, but still you write Internet of Things the first time you say. Okay, wireless sensor network. And the first time you say, you always state the statement as a abbreviation has to be a full image. Now comes the simulation model, whatever. So suppose you have an analytical model. Suppose you have an analytical model, then what are things you should give? First, give the big picture so that he understands what you are trying to do with this model. Suppose you are, let's say, for example, you want to model a channel modeling. First, you give him the concept like, okay, I am trying to do wireless channel modeling. In this wireless channel modeling, I am going to go for some kind of fading modeling. In the fading modeling also, these are the sub-parameters which I have. And then you write the equation. When you write the equation, clearly mention the parts of the equation, step by step by step. This paragraph, this variable means this, this variable means this. This is the unit of that particular variable which I'm using, dB I'm using, dBm I'm using. So like that, okay, step by step by step. No hurry buddy here, take your time, explain every part of the equation. Because if an equation is faulty, of course it may not be faulty, but if it is faulty, the reviewer must be able to simulate and check it once, whatever you're telling is true or not. Okay, so you always have to mention the parts of the equation. You cannot leave a single variable unexplained in that equation, if writing an equation. Okay, including the sign. There's a minus sign, you must explain why you're negating it, why you're adding it, why is it complex number, why is it not a real number, all those things. All parameter has to be defined. If you possible, make it as a tabular form. That is not bad. It's a very good idea to write it as a tabular form. Okay. So let's go further. If it is simulation, that is, you're not doing mathematical modeling, you're actually doing a simulation of a system. That is, somebody has given a model, you're just simulating it and trying it out. There are some papers which are implementation based. Somebody proposes an idea, other fellow implements it. For example, a PhD fellow may propose an idea, a M.Tech fellow or an undergraduate student may try to simulate and show some results. Those things are possible. If it's simulation, explain the parameters used properly. Which simulator have you used has to be explained. If you're using MATLAB simulator or NS2 simulator, NS3 simulators, or if you're using an equipment, you must explain what equipment have you used for simulating this particular device. What is the make and model which you are following? What is the version of that? In fact, just by writing MATLAB Simulink or something, it's not sufficient. You must say MATLAB version this, Simulink version this, toolbox this I have used. This is the release version. This is the release date which I have used. Sometimes what happens, you write your own simulators. It's called stubs. Has something you don't have, so just replace it with a simulator. And that, if you are doing on your own, you must mention if it has been tested with a reputed publication result. This means, suppose you write a simulator, and if you expect the reviewer to believe that the simulator is correct, you must test that simulator against a reputed publication result. You must match it. Okay, this is very important. Otherwise, they will not believe you. Now comes the results and the discussion area. Results and discussion are the last part of it. Actually, if you see, I explained in the order of writing where results and discussion comes. Results comes towards the end, not the first. You don't write the results first. You always write towards the end. So, define the parameters considered for the calculation. It's sometimes possible you may have made some assumptions. Okay, when I calculate this, I assume that the dB range is so and so and so, or noise level is so and so. So you have to explain some conditions maybe which you have unconsciously assumed, but the reviewer may not know that you have assumed that, right? So whenever you write a result, you have to explain whatever things you have, parameters you have used, define the range. Suppose I am doing a BER plot, noise calculation, or SNR level is from here to here. So like that, you must always tell the range also. All this has to be written, if possible, in a table form. Nothing wrong in that. If you have a graph, you should define what is x axis and what is y axis with the unit. Sometimes people draw BER graph, the error graph or whatever, and they forget to write dB. This logarithmic scale, linear scale has to be mentioned. Okay, every point needs to be shown properly. You must tell what modeling, like for example, if you are using a simulator, you say, okay, I did for a Monte Carlo simulation for this range of millions of errors or at 10 to the minus 6 level of noise, whatever. You have to explain all the x-axis and the y-axis properly. You cannot leave it hanging. You can't let the reviewer assume something. Him assuming something is very bad for the paper. Okay. Always explicitly mention what it is with the unit. Always remember with unit. And then comes explain the result logically. Don't say mathematically I got this curve. Logically, why you should get that curve? You should explain, because you are the one who did the research, you found the graph, you found the plot, and you find that this is better than that. Why it came better than that? Not because the mathematics told you to do so. You must try to find a logical explanation for that. Okay, once you try to explain logically, then the paper gets accepted easier. You can't tell the reviewers, go see my simulation results, I got it, so I am showing it. No, you have to explain logically why this graph is better than that. Even if you say why it is better than the other, you should explain why your result is better than the other. That is, first explain the curve and explain why it is better. For example, if you get a BER plot which is better, or you get better noise figures or better bit rates, you should explain why it is better than other. That is, what is the wrong thing in the previous thing which you overcame by your method? That has to be explained. And then, this is very important, take a reference point on the curve and explain for a particular x and y value what you got and why you got that value. One point, take any point, whichever is convenient for you. Let's say a dB at 20 minus 10 dB, I got this value and this is the reason why you got this value. So once you point the figure and you explain the curve and then you explain one point on the curve, the full thing is, the whole cycle is completed. The results gets complete. Results are the part we neglect a lot in writing, okay? Not in simulation, in writing. Because we are physically and mentally tired after writing the introduction, the proposed idea. Okay, this I have seen multiple times. Even I have done myself this mistake multiple times. Because in the order of writing, I have showed you, result is almost towards the end. So by the time you write the introduction and then you write the conclusion, and by the time you finish method simulation, you are done with so much of the effort, then you think our results are automatically coming out. Enough, I've done enough, let's publish it. The reason becomes that the deadline is coming very close by for the conference to publish. Hari hari bari bari mein, we'll finish, show some results and submit it. You assume that, oh, I got, these things are done, so this is acceptable. No, it is not acceptable. Because I showed you the order of writing the paper. I did not tell you the order of reading a paper. Reading a paper is not explained here, okay? That's for the reviewers, for people like me who review conferences. Okay, a reviewer doesn't have time to read in this order. No, these are not the order in which to read. Okay, so results, though it is towards the end, you must write it very patiently. Do not push it. Always have a guide or your mentor as a reference and show to him once. So this is the result which I am writing. Please go through once. Okay. Okay. In this section, this is the only section where you prove with numbers that your concept is correct and better than the rest. This is the proof. Okay. So no other way, every other way, you just make statements, words, not numbers. So here with numbers, you prove it. So this is the most, is the heart of the paper if you want to say as a researcher. Okay, this is the heart of the result. So you have to be very careful when you write the heart of it, right? So you can't make any mistake. You can't even make a plus mistake or a minus mistake, a minus dB, plus dB, no calculation mistakes has to be shown. And this section has to be revised multiple times, reviewed multiple times, and there should not be any error here. Okay, it's not acceptable at all. Because the moment you write a wrong result here, you will be telling that you are plagiarizing, you are doing a wrong result, intentionally distorting the values, and you are claiming magical numbers, and they will not give you credit, and you will be barred. Okay, so responsible authors will be careful while writing results. See, please understand, the reviewer who has accepted your work till result section will only accept after going through the proof of numbers and results. Without seeing the proof and the result, no one is going to accept the paper. Just because you write in very good English or you write everything mathematically, the graph looks nice, the plot looks nice, still it does not accept, does not make the paper acceptable. Okay, results are very important. Then comes the conclusion section. Conclusion is the same as the abstract. Okay, almost it's a copy paste. Don't copy paste, but just rewrite the same statements in a different way, but you may elaborate the first two sentences of the abstract. Okay, and you tell you what is your contribution in this domain. Your contribution. You write your future work, but with caution. What is the caution you should take? The caution is that you must not give ideas to next reviewer or the reviewer to say, oh, this guy has not missed out this thing. Let I do the same thing and I publish a paper before you finish your work. It should not be a race around condition. So when you write future work, don't write the immediate future work. I did the simulation till 10 dB, the next 20 dB I will do next. Don't write that kind of statements. Some twists and turns may be there. So you write a future work, which is something which you may even not do it today or for next 2-3 years. That kind of future work you can explain. Okay, please be with caution, because this is where people read the paper and they write one paper better than yours and publish it before you could even think of publishing your paper yet. Okay, be careful with conclusion, that future work. Some points I want to give. So give me 5 more minutes and I'll conclude. So then we'll take the question answers if you have any. Never, ever, ever copy from others or your own paper. Sometimes what happens is you have written multiple papers. This happens to some people who had multiple papers. Oh, I want to done some work and I have done some enhancement over my previous work. So I will refer my previous work in the current paper. When you do that, you must always, always give reference and write in your own language. I tell it again and again and again, because this point cannot be stressed further. It has to be written in your own language. Do not copy paste and give reference. If you copy and paste from others, and suppose some things which you cannot avoid, and your previous accepted paper, in plagiarism test, similar score will be high. This is a fact. If you directly copy paste, automatically the similarity goes sky, the similarity score goes up. Okay, because in a conference, 1,000 papers get put for review. Only 150 or so may get through. So the cut is 1 in 8 or 1 in 9 papers. So human can't go through all the papers manually fully. So they automatically do some level of screening at the beginning itself. That's why the talk itself has started with plagiarism and similarity index. If you don't pass through, they won't even read the paper. They'll just throw it away. Okay. Before submission, check if you get a similarity score ahead of time. So there are some softwares some conferences which give you this results ahead of time. So they will not directly reject you. They will say, see, this is a similar score. Can you verify it better? Can you make it better? So this helps you, giving you a time for you to rework and submit again. So sometimes they say, call for papers, early call for papers. Or like that you can give. References should be in the IEEE format if you're writing an IEEE paper. And for each section, there's a section how to review. I mean, if you're writing a paper, if you're reviewing a paper, if you're giving a reference to a paper, or giving reference to a book chapter, or giving reference to a web link, website link, there is a format for that. You can't directly write http://. No, that's not how you refer, give a reference to a web link. There's a format in which you have to give. This is a separate topic which will come when you do paper writing in the context of the conference itself. It's conference dependent. Spelling and grammar check is a must before submission. You cannot have very bad spelling. That is very simple right now, because you have Google, we have this Word and all. You can just copy paste Word and see any grammatic mistakes are there. But please do this before you submit. Some people have because of a small spelling mistakes, a BER and SER. Sounds very close by. Symbol error rate and bit error rate. One word here and there has a big change in meaning actually. Off key and on key has a much big different meaning. So you always do a spelling and grammar check once before doing. So this is my parting thoughts. Always think that you can do it, as you have all the qualities to be a good engineer. Always don't lose confidence, okay? You don't think, oh, I can't write a paper, I can't do this, I can't, no. Always think that you have all the qualities required. Nothing is missing in you. Be humble and learn and follow the steps. Be humble, because once you have some results, you become arrogant. I have seen this happen to many of my young engineers, also happened to me once or twice. I have got best results. I have beaten my own previous papers, or I have beaten my own professors. So this kind of arrogance should not come, especially for masters and PhD candidates. Arrogance should not come in you. You must be always humble. Okay, and follow the steps step by step. The order I told you, right, in that order only. There's a reason for all this. After submitting the paper, don't stop. Don't think, kaam ho gaya, let's close the shop and go home. No, you have to think further. Thinking of new problems is a continuous process. Human brain is sharp and loves innovation. Always remember, you always like something new, whether it's TV or video games or whatever. It's always new which you like. You don't want to see the whole thing again and again and again. So your brain is tuned to see something new. Whatever you have solved, maybe you missed out some parameters. Maybe you tried to do some other things in different way. A small variable change here and there, and adding a variable, removing a variable, it may give different flavors to the same project. So please think. This is my parting thought for this talk, and thank you for listening to me patiently. I think I have some 10-15 minutes, if anything, for question and answers. Over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Sir, I have a question.
Okay.
So can you give us like a small brief on how exactly the references are added, if possible?
References. Okay, yes. Just hold on a second, let me see. So this is a paper which I wrote myself with my colleague. So if you see an example, are you able to see the slide, right? So here, if you see, I'm referring at a conference paper, a review paper basically. And I should explain the author first. If there are multiple authors, you write the first author and write it all, means everybody else, the title of the paper or the conference paper in double quotes, and say which volume, what pages are you referring to, and which year is the year of publication. This is how you refer a conference paper. Simple example I'm just trying to say here. Okay.
So it's not that we go and like take it from their link or something. It's like handwritten, you're saying. Let's say if I'm referring your paper, I write the reference saying Anand and then the name of your paper and then where it's published.
Yes.
Excuse me, sir.
Tell me.
usually in every conferences there will be this option as cite as citation download. Like, can't we take from there, or we have to do it like manually, like how you are telling?
No. See, exactly. So again, when you take a reference, because a journal may have a different way of referencing, and a public conference paper may have different way of publishing. In certain places, they write the content first, the author second, and so on and so. So there are different ways in which the references are written depending upon the publication. Some journals write differently.
So what's the IEEE format?
Yeah, that you have to see the format of that conference. Go to the conference website to download it. They will show you, give the reference of the template itself. In the template, you can follow. This is the IEEE way. This is a conference paper which I have written for IEEE only. In this, this is how I have written. Of course, this is how
so
I have
as
given.
Per the format, we write it, right? Like, as I stated, that if we know that we are going to put the author name, the author title, and where it's published, we take it from the paper and put it.
You can do that. There's nothing wrong with that.
Okay.
It is just that it is, some people have a pattern of writing certain ways. So you follow the same pattern. For example, you're publishing into a some conference called IEEE Connect. You see last year's papers and see how they are written. You follow the same procedure. It is the thing is, you don't want to create a format issue just because of that. No, it takes 5 minutes to read and go and do things. So I'm not here focusing on the template of the conference. I'm just focusing on the order and the content to be written.
Yes.
And, so always. Sorry. Yeah.
And sir, how is the references ordered to be, sir? Like.
No. It's always the way you write the paper itself. If the paper has, we are referring to paper one, you write that is the first reference. Then comes two, okay, and then comes 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, then 7, 8, 9 to 11. Here, if you see,
doesn't year of publication play a role?
No, it does not. It does not, because typically when you click one, we expect it to be the first one to go through. Typically, but there may be some, again, I'm telling you, because some magazines may have a reverse way. There are different ways of writing. One more thing I'll tell you. The references is not just a link. It may also be a clickable link also. Right now, this is not clickable here. You see, it's not clickable. But there are some references, there are some conferences will enforce. This has to be clickable. When you click this one, it automatically goes to the reference section and shows you what reference it is. So that is the other way. So what I suggest exactly is, please see the conferences previous year's papers, how they have written. Because the one which is published is the one which is accepted by the conference organizers. So you better follow that particular conference's format. Because that's not one universal standard. It's always varying actually. I've seen it multiple times. So typically I follow as in, because many times I have followed, the order is more or less the way in which I want the story to go. I don't suddenly refer in the first paragraph itself referring to a 20th reference. No, I generally don't do that. It creates a wrong impression actually itself. In the beginning, when you read a paper, you get annoyed actually. What did they get? This guy can't even write, think properly, because it's a thought flow which matters. So when you start flowing, you always write, because the way I told you to write the paper itself, no, automatically it follows. Where the first line of the abstract is the domain itself. First paragraph of the paper is the domain itself. So automatically the first paper reference will be a textbook most probably, or survey paper, or some big conference, like very famous paper of the domain. You always follow that way. And second, third line will be the existing algorithm. So all existing papers will come somewhere here. So the order of this reference automatically get aligned, because the way I told you to write the abstract, it follows in certain order. Introduction also follows the abstract itself. So they mostly it will be aligned. If you start writing this in a wrong way, write the abstract wrongly, then automatically everything gets shuffled a little bit.
Yes.
So please follow the order I suggested.
Sure, sir. Okay. So there are a few more questions which is there in the chat box. There's one question saying, is there any kind of free software for plagiarism checking?
Yeah, there's something called Turnitin. T-U-R and Turnitin. I just wrote that somewhere. I can just show you. So there are some websites which you can see. for plagiarism check, yes. But what I suggest always is, you go to a professor of your, I mean, of course, you have a lot of professors in your colleges or institutions, or if you have friends who are professors, they will be in these conferences.
Yes, okay,
they'll be one of these members of this conference. You tell him, he may have access to this kind of tools for checking, for plagiarism. So in that scenario, you can always get it done, help it. Okay, sir, please just can check. But best is that you ensure yourself, at least consciously, that you don't copy any statement. Convert that word to a mother tongue, bring it back to English, automatically it will go away. I have tried this multiple times. It has worked wonderfully. Because English, our English is not the proper English, you understand, right? It's always English mixing all of things. So there are some ways to do, yes.
Okay, so another question is, what is the percentage of plagiarism for a journal paper and a conference paper?
I can't explain what is the percentage means. Actually, the problem is the quality of paper and the forcing of the students to write a paper. There's two different things, actually. A paper writing should not be forced. It should be natural for an engineer. You did some work, obviously you want to share to the world, right? So you get name and fame, recognition. So writing a paper should not be a forced activity. It has to come naturally. Once it comes naturally, that means you have some results which you want to show. I'll give you examples, okay? Sometimes you want to get promoted in your job, so you write some papers. Sometimes you want to get a degree, so you write a paper. That should not be the motivation. The motivation should that I did some work, I want to show the work. So plagiarism will automatically go away. Of course, I'm not telling that there is no plagiarism in the world, but I show you the list actually. It's very alarming actually. Actually, India is the top, and then close by is China. So a couple of meetings I have set, and I have listened to these people complaining that Indians don't write original papers. So I don't want the people to do that. That's why the first topic which I have spoken is about plagiarism only. Do not copy paste.
Yes, sir.
Okay? Yeah, and there are a lot of people who.
I'm actually reading out the questions of different people, sir.
Yeah, sure.
So there is another question which says, sir, is the reference should be sequential or referred randomly? So how do I identify a Scopus Index journal?
That is tough because I told you already that references preferentially has to be sequential. And if you follow the template which I've given you, it will always mostly becomes sequential. Okay, that's one answer. You can always follow the previous conference's papers or a professor's papers himself. We can follow and see how he's writing. You get some ideas about it. Preferably sequential. Of course, if you are forced to be non-sequels, that's out of scope. Then regarding Scopus Index journals, up to you. Basically, there are a lot of people who force you to write in UGC approved journals and all those things. But better than me telling, it's better that your guide guides you to the perfect journal. So I think it's left to the choice of the, because it also matters about money. It also matters about time and effort. So some conferences may charge very heavy. Some journals may charge heavy. Some journals may not charge heavy. So it's up to a lot of many factors are involved. Date and time of the conference may matter, because for you are finishing your MTech thesis and you published before January. So a lot of criteria comes in, not just the paper. So I don't want to discuss explicitly, but that's generally the way it is. Anything else?
So there's a question saying, we have to write complete author name and there is no et al in the reference. I don't know what it means.
Yeah, actually, this et al word is something which is a French word or something, I think. So okay. if you write so much all the author's name, it may become too long. So you write the first author and you just put an et al and you just write the remaining paper. Nothing wrong in that. But if the conference organizers object to it explicitly, or your professor objects to it explicitly, then I suggest taking a weaker stance. The reason why is, otherwise you have a limitation on the number of pages you submit into a conference. It's a five page or six page.
Yes.
Nothing beyond that is possible. So because reference comes in the last and you've written so much masala in the middle part of it that you don't have much space for references itself. So this reference is the cushion which you just adjust with it and fit it somehow, jugaad karke something. So you squeeze in a little bit and two things. So that's what I want to say.
Yes.
But some people may enforce, okay, strictly speaking, you must write full, okay. So telling me strictly, then I'll follow strictly. But this is another way which I've done multiple times.
Yes, sir.
Then next.
So other question says, student, I'm a student of MBA. Currently, I've completed my academic project. In that, I have completely confused in review of literature, but anyhow, I have finished, but what are the things should have in the review of literature?
Oh, literature survey. Literature survey is a different domain altogether. So actually, I suggest that you attend a research methodology workshop. This is a paper writing which I'm talking right now. As a method to do research, even if we can take a separately some other time if we have time for that. How to do research, how to do literature survey. It's a separate domain study to do. You cannot haphazardly read a paper and do something, I'm done with it. No. So literature survey is a different skill altogether because you don't have much time, and within the first 6 months, you must at least condense and say, okay, this is the domain which I want to do research in. So I suggest that there's a separate workshop called Research Methodology Workshop, which IEEE conducts. Please attend that. If that is not possible, at least I suggest that some other session, if we can, we will see how to do this literature survey as a first step in research. So research is a domain. In that, paper writing is the last step. The first step is literature survey. So today's scope is out of scope. So let's see some other time when we can do talk about research, we'll talk about this topic. But I suggest the question below to talk to his professors. That's the best way right now I can do.
Yes, sir. So there's one last question which says, are there any free Scopus index journals, as nowadays conferences are indexing in Scopus are amount of 10K?
Yeah, that is something which I can't help you with. So I'm sorry for that. There is no free lunch in the world. Okay.
Yeah.
So let us say that for sake of argument, if you have conference in the content of the material, more than going through the Scopus index journals, you can directly try to publish in IEEE transactions and IEEE journals, which they don't charge you.
Yes.
So because they are heavily peer reviewed and lot of push pull happens, so it is much more tightly reviewed, so you don't have to pay a single paisa.
Yes, sir.
So I suggest you go through that method rather than going through Scopus. Of course, many of the people have to finish their master's, they have to go through Scopus or to do finish their PhD, they have to show journal. So I can't help you there. There's no free lunch, sorry.
And there's one more question which says, as we read more and more paper, we feel that our research is already done. How do we go about?
Yes, yes, that is the dilemma of a researcher, okay? So you have to be the first to get the cherry, otherwise you will lose around the race. It's a race, it's an absolute race. So always when you read the problem is you read one domain and then you do research in that domain and you find, oh, I thought about this, it's already there. I thought about this already there. So what you must do is in that scenario, again, I'll suggest this is not a paper writing problem, it is a research problem. So we'll take this a separate time, but for time being, I will just answer this by telling you have to do interdisciplinary research. Try to do about a biology with a virus communication, or a chemistry with a computer science equations. So try to mix two domains which are nowhere related to each other, then you can get something new. So like cooking only it is. So I suggest that since lunchtime, I hope that, I'm thinking about all this food and stuff. So yeah, so just to try to be innovative in that domain. Try to mix two domains which are not linked to each other at all. Genetic algorithm, genetics and algorithm. No, nothing to see if you see things. Okay, wireless communication and underwater communication. There's no direct link if you see, but you can do a lot of work in that. So there are a lot of domains which are not related to each other. So I suggest you talk to one fellow who is in life sciences or arts and literature. For example, they do machine learning on Shakespeare's novels. Not related to anything which you can think about. So there are the ways to do things.
Yes. So we're done with the questions.
Okay, thank you then.
Thank you so much for your time. Thank you for giving us a brief on how to write a paper. It surely helped all of us. We will work on many more.
Sure. Good. So please follow the slides. Please do things sincerely. Always be humble to your professors.
Yes.
Ask their help, even if they just scold you, shout at you, yell at you, just bear it, because it is for our benefit that they do that, not for their benefit.
Sure, sir. All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.